back into the wild, and don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces, graces waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, graces waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is His healer, there be freedom. Let there be freedom. Bring all of your burdens and bring all of your scars. Prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Come on.
Pins by hold, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lock me hold, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Graces waiting. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Graces waiting.
Dance like the weight has been lifted. Graces.
Every praise belongs to our God, our King, our Lord. He deserves our praise. He's a good God. We serve a good God.
Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship with one accord. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God.
His name would burst from sea and sky.
I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me through the fire, I'll rejoice cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings, I hold fast in what is true. And if the cross brings transformation,
You
your power.
Atmosphere is changing now. Well, the Spirit of the Lord is here. Hallelujah. Begin to lift up your hands this morning. Begin to lift up your hands this morning. Receive your miracle. The Spirit of God is here this morning. He's here this morning. You've come here expecting a miracle. Hallelujah. Looking to the Lord, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Anything can happen now. The Spirit of the Lord is here. The Spirit of God is here. I thank you, Lord God, that you are taking chains, weights and chains. I just see somebody's come in this place and you've been dragging a ball and chain. That's getting cut off for your feet right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. And I see weights have been placed on people. It's like situations in household. Someone's put that heaviness on you. I just see the Spirit of God lifting that weight off of your shoulders. Lifting that weight. It is going now. It is going now. It is going now. And I thank you, Lord God, that that migraine headache is ceasing as from now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, you are a miracle working God. Father, I thank you for that marriage. I pull out that wedge that's gone in the marriage, and I thank you for restoring that marriage. Restoring that marriage to better than it's ever been before. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord God, that contention and striving ceases in that house right now in the name of Jesus, and that you release the family, Lord God, that's going through pressure because of lack of finances. You're releasing that family this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I thank you for your provision. For your provision. For your provision where there's been a lack. I call that financial blessing in from the north, the south, and the east and the west. Supernatural provision. I thank you, Lord God. Someone's receiving it right now. Right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to your holy name this morning. Praise you, Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Niels and Elsaby, I've seen this morning that you were lifting up your glasses to the Lord, and he was just overflowing it. He was overflowing it. You were lifting it up to him. Hallelujah. Overflowing blessing coming your way. Glory, glory to your name. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Mavis, I just got that word for you. Fear not, God says, for I am with you. Fear not, for I am with you, says the Lord. I just see the Lord strengthening you and lifting you up, and he's just going to pour out his blessing upon you in a mighty way. I just see that you've got love and support. People are calling out your name, your husband's name, before the living God. God is with you, daughter of the Most High. I just see God bringing you into a new place that you've never experienced before, into a place of peace, into a place of wholeness, into a place of deliverance, into a place of restoration. God is going to bring you into a new place. And I just see that you're a woman that is going to just come on bended knee before the living God. I know you've been doing that, but I just see you coming in a greater way. Your cries, I just see your cries are going to touch the Father's ears. Your cries are going to be heard. Hallelujah. Glory, glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I've forgotten your name now. Nelia. Hallelujah. Nelia, hallelujah. Father, I just thank you for Nelia. I just see like a bulldog nature, like a tenacity, like a bulldozer in the spiritual realm. I just see that you're an intercessor and you're just going to plow over the darkness. You're going to power over those situations that have come before you, the obstacles. I just see you getting on that bulldozer in the spirit, and it's like you're going to plow the fields of other people where there's been obstructive things taking place, where there's been storms, darkness. I just see a woman of tenacity, a woman of tenacity. You have a backbone of steel, and regardless of everything that's come against you and what the enemy is throwing against you, you're going to just shake it off. Just like Paul the Apostle shook that serpent off, you're going to shake it off, and you're just going to go stronger and stronger. Hallelujah. Stronger in the Lord. And I just see God pouring out blessing upon you, blessing upon you, blessing upon you and your family and upon your loved ones. God is going to bring change even in family members that have concerned you. There's family members that are laying heavy upon your heart. I just see as you call the name of the Lord, there's some things that God is going to perfect that have concerneth you. Glory to the Lord. Hallelujah. And Orville, I just see that you're booting the enemy outside your front door. It's like the powers of darkness. You're not allowing that to get into your house or into your heart or into your mind. You're going to boot that enemy out. Hallelujah. And I just see God's going to give you that tenacity on the inside of you. And you're going to be a man that's going to break through new limitations. I just see boundaries that have been around you. They're going to be broken, and there's limitations going to be broken. And you're going to be a man that's going to be liberated. You're going to be a man on fire. And they're going to say, Macha, what has happened to you? Hallelujah, glory, glory. Hallelujah. I don't know your name. Shannon, hallelujah. I just see, Shannon, that the Lord's calling you to come closer, come closer. He wants to just shower you with his love, with his blessing. I just see the Lord wants you to just come and sit upon his lap, upon his knee, like Abba Daddy, and he's going to just talk to you. And I just see God wants you to know that he's going to cause new things to take place in your life. I just see new doors opening. There's old ones that are getting ready to close behind you, and there's getting new doors getting ready to open. And God is going to give you the desire of your heart. I just see it's a new season opening up for you, a new season. It's like the season of discouragement is coming to an end. The season of gloom and doom is closing up, and a new season. I just see a new season of new beginnings, a new season of blessing, a new season of heart's desire being fulfilled. God is going to move mightily on your behalf, and I just see that he's going to fan the flame. I just see your man that's going to be on fire for God. You're going to be on fire. I just see like the word of God that has been sown in your heart, he's going to become alive. It's going to become alive, and you're going to break out of the old mold, and you're going to come into the new. I just see you standing with a man with hands lifted up before the living God. God is going to shower down his grace, his mercy, his love. And I just see there's things that you were holding on to. It's like I just see you placing it on the altar of God, and you're releasing those things, and things that have even hurt you, things that have wounded you. I just see the Lord setting you free, and I pull out the barbs and the arrows that have gone in and have wounded you, the negative words that have been spoken. I break the power of those negative words, and I declare life, resurrection, life and power. And I just see a man that's committed, a man that's dressed in the army of God. Hallelujah. You're there, you're positioning yourself, and I just see you coming up higher. You're coming up higher. You're coming up higher. It is a new day. It is a new hour when God is transforming you. There is a change in the inward man. Hallelujah. You shall never be the same again. Glory, glory. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Charmaine, you are a woman of the word. I just see the word so etched inside of your heart. And Barry, when I thought about you, I just see your eyes are eyes of love. And it's the eyes of love when we look at others, and it's looking through Jesus' eyes into others. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Eyes of love. Eyes of love. Eyes of compassion. Glory to your name. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Mighty, mighty God. Hallelujah. June and Alan. Hallelujah. You just bring the glory of God wherever you go. And I just see that God's going to use you more and more. He's going to use you more and more. I just see a new joy, a new spring in your step coming. Hallelujah. And you're just going to radiate. People that are walking in darkness, they're going to look at you and they're going to say, there's something different about this couple. Let's go and see them. There's something different about this couple. And they're going to inquire of you. And it's going to be such a pleasure for you to tell them about Jesus, about your life, about your testimony of what God has done. And I just see you laying your hands on people and you're praying for them, and it's like, wow, that pain went, wow, they're feeling different. And you're just going to be so surprised, and God's going to energize you, because the joy of the Lord is going to be your strength and your stronghold. God is just going to do amazing things in your life, and I just see blessings being poured out upon you. You've poured it out on other people, and God's going to pour it out on you, and it's going to be pressed down, shaken together, running over. Hallelujah. God is going to do amazing and mighty things for you. Chang, I just see the Lord wrapping his loving arms around about you. He's healing you. He's restoring you. He's setting you free from every spirit of rejection. The Lord says that he is more than enough for you. And as you entwine yourself with the living God, I just see God going to give you an amazing peace. He's going to give you an amazing peace, and you're going to find emotional wounds healed. God is going to heal you of wounds that have been there for donkey's years. God is going to pour his healing balm, and he's just going to come and heal you, and you're just going to know there's something different. There's something that has shifted in the spiritual realm, and you're not going to be a man that's going to be feeling the way you've been feeling. I just see there's going to come a change on the inside of you. God is going to heal you and restore you on the inside. You're going to feel a new man, a new man. And people are going to look at you and they're going to see a new man. I just see a new man of confidence, a new man of peace, a new man that's not inadequate in any area. And you're just going to walk in the power of God. And I just see you're going to drop those things of the past. You're not going to be looking back as looking through that vision mirror, but you're going to let it go. You're going to let it go. You're going to let go, and you're going to let God. And you're going to let God, and you're going to allow God to move in on the scene and God to do awesome things in your life. Hallelujah. I am the God of all mankind. Is there anything too hard for me to do? As for me and my house, Chang, we shall serve the Lord. Glory to your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just see the Lord going to set you free. He's going to set you free. I just see there's been chains, there's been restrictions, there's been things that have been holding you back, and the Lord is going to deliver you from a spirit of fear. He's going to set you free from when you were a little girl. I just had a vision the other day that you were a little girl and you were running away because there was fear in your heart, and the Lord is going to deliver you, and you are going to know the power of God. I just see the Lord bringing you closer to his heart. It's like your heartbeat is going to beat for the things of God, and there's going to come a boldness on the inside of you, a boldness. And you're just going to, I just see that there's an evangelistic spirit there, and you're going to evangelize, and you're going to tell others about Jesus. You're going to open up. It's like your heart is going to be so new, and you're going to open up, and you're going to tell others about Jesus, and you're going to pray for them. And I just see God's going to set you free from timidity. He's going to set you free from shyness. He's going to set you free from insecurity. And you're just going to know you've got the power of God, and God is going to use you in a mighty, mighty way. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And I just see the Lord calls you son. He says, son, come closer. Come closer. I have much to tell you. Come closer. And I just see as you come closer to the living God, he's going to lift off all the burdens, all the pressure, all the stress that's been around about you, all the fears, all the worries of the future. God's going to release you and set you free. And he's going to just put a new song in your mouth. I just hear you even singing as you're doing your work, even singing as you're going to the supermarket. God's going to put a new joy within you. He's going to release you from every oppression, every depressive spirit that has tried to come and annoy you. He's going to release you from all that harassment, all that torment. He's going to lift off. I just see a weight going to come off of you. Hallelujah. And you're going to know the peace of God. You're going to know the healing power of God moving in a mighty way. God is going to move in a mighty way on your behalf. Hallelujah. Glory, glory to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Almighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And there's some people this morning and you need to hear, because Jesus lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. I'm just sensing this morning that there's people, your fear of being left alone, your fear of not knowing what to do, your fear what the future will hold, your fear of not having enough, your fear of just being abandoned and left to go in life on your own. The Lord has not given you a spirit of fear, but he's given you a love, power, and a sound mind. And I just see that fear is being released right now off of your shoulders. There's a number of people here this morning, and you've been fearing the future. It's like that is being lifted off of your shoulder this morning. Hallelujah. Because Jesus lives, all fear is gone. Amen. Hallelujah. All fear is gone. Amen. Because he lives, that makes all the difference. Hallelujah. We can go on. Glory to the Lord. Rochelle, I was thinking about you, Rochelle, and I was thinking about when Mary prepared Jesus for the burial. She poured out of that alabaster box that aroma, that perfume. And Rochelle, I just see the time that you spent with Lorraine, preparing her for eternity. That it's like I thought about that alabaster box and the perfume and your life and the things that you spoke about and you done in these last days, and you were preparing Lorraine for eternity. There was such a beauty, such an aroma that was flowing out of your life. There was Jesus all over it. And I think about when the woman poured that perfume out, the whole room was filled with the fragrance, and the whole room, Rochelle, that you were in was filled with the fragrance of Jesus. And I thought about that word in Ephraim, what Joseph named his second son. And that means you made me fruitful in the land of my suffering. And that's what the Lord has done for you, Rochelle. He has made you fruitful in the land of your suffering. And we are praying for you and your family at this difficult time. Let's lift up Rochelle and her family. Father, we just lift up Rochelle and her entire family this morning, Father God. Lord, that you will just touch them at this difficult time. Father, that you will embrace every one of them individually, wrapping around your presence, Lord God. Your presence, wrap around presence, Father God. Embracing this family, Father God, in this difficult time of sorrow, of loss, of mourning, Father God, of disappointment, Lord. That you would just wrap your healing love around this family, Lord Jesus. That you will show yourself strong on their behalf. I thank you, Father God, that there's been many seeds that have been sown, that, Father God, mighty things are going to take place. The miraculous will be seen, Lord God. Father, for Rochelle's tears were not in vain. They were not in vain, Lord God. I thank you that in the days to come, Father God, she will see many things and many answers will come, Lord God, for what you have done in her life. Bless her mightily, Father God. Hallelujah. And Kathy Harrison, I just see the rain of God's presence just falling down upon you. The rain of God's presence is just showering you, refreshing you, just giving you a new spring in your step. And I just see blessings, blessings, Kathy, blessings coming to you. Hallelujah. And no good thing will he withhold from those whose walk is upright. You're a woman of strength and tenacity on the inside. I just see a woman of supernatural strength, and you're running through the wall, running over the wall and jumping through the troop. Hallelujah. God's given you such a power, such an anointing on the inside. You're a woman of authority, and I just see you speaking, and those things going, discouragement going, oppressive spirits leaving as you begin to speak and as you begin to call those things that aren't as though they were. You're a woman that's walking by faith. And I just see as you begin to call those things in, you are going to see the dynamic move of God moving in a mighty way for you. Hallelujah.
Amen. Glorify his name, church. He is worthy of praise. He is worthy of glory and honor and power. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Machang. Yara is speaking some Singhalese words. Machang is brother-in-law. Preach, Machang. And donkey is here, so. We need to pray for Dindi today. Mavis' husband is in hospital. He's taking radio. According to the doctor, he's got cancer, stage 4 cancer. But that's nothing for Jesus. I said, there is nothing for Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
That cancer has to leave, and he's got to leave right now. You know why he's got to leave right now? Because he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's here right now. As Yara said before, man, wasn't the worship awesome? These guys are going from one level of glory to another. Amen. There is an open heaven church over this place. Whatever you need, okay, healing. I'm going to pray for Dindi right now. I want you all to come. Those on social media, just come and join me with prayer for Dindi. He needs a miracle today. You know, he needs a miracle right now. That cancer, we have seen people, even in our church, 14 years ago, they had cancer, stage 4 cancer. It's all gone. It's all clear of cancer. Deanna, we prayed for her, and it's all gone. Just hang on to the blood of Christ every time when you pray for your husband. Just see, and we come in agreement right now. Anyone else who needs a miracle, somebody have got pain on their back. Chandana, I think you've got pain on your back, but there could be somebody else as well. It just came to me, somebody on Zoom or anywhere else. Just reach out to the Lord, and right now as we come in agreement in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father God. Lord, as we come in a corporate anointing, Lord, we join our faith together, Lord. Oh, Lord, you are a faithful God, Lord. You are a faithful God, Lord, as we come together in unity, Lord God, for Dindi right now and everyone else who needs a miracle, Lord, as we lift him up before you right now, Lord, and we call out to you right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. Right now, Lord, we believe your report, Lord, that by your wounds that Dindi is healed, Lord. You bled and died, Lord, you took that sickness, Lord. You took that cancer and you nailed it on Calvary, Lord. We thank you for Lord, for what you have done, Lord God. Lord, you release him today, Lord, from every attack that has come against him. Lord, even from the day Dindi was conceived in his mother's womb, right up to this day, Lord, we break every curse, every assignment, every voodoo prayer, every charm, every hex, every spell, Lord, that have been spoken, Lord, over Dindi and over this family, Lord God. We smash it and break it in the name of Jesus. We pull out those daggers right out of his back, right out of his mind, Lord. We pull out every negative thought, every negative word. We pluck them out right now. And we release dunamis power, Lord. Resurrection power. Lama shaki di barandana. Resurrection power. The same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Lord, we release that resurrection power right now into those soulish wounds, into his body right now. We curse the very root of that cancer. We command it to shrivel up and die in the mighty name of Jesus right now. By the power of the Holy Ghost, we command that spirit of infirmity and every negative report, every negative doctor's report. Lord, we believe the report of the Lord that you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Right now, Lord, that your healing power is flowing through Dindi, Lord. Because there is no distance in prayer, Lord. Everyone, Lord, that back is straightening up right now. Lord, those vertebrae disc right now, we command them to come into divine alignment. Lord, we command all that stress and pressure, Lord. Lord, even the things of the past, Lord, we smash them and break the power of them in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for rapid healing to those body parts right now. Those body parts, church, they will live and not die. I said, believe me right now, come together, everyone at the sound of my voice right now and beyond, in the name of Jesus. Those body parts, according to God's word, they will live and not die. They will live and not die to declare the works of the Lord in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We give you the power, the glory, Lord, all to you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Give the Lord a clap, church, right now. Thank you, Father. Mashukara. Come on, church, you can do better than that. At a football game, you do better than that. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Krama sopre in dele kiriangene masora malangana. To God be the glory. Great things He have done. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Barry, when Yara was giving you that word, you know, that love that is going to come into you when you look at people, because there is no condemnation for anyone. It doesn't matter where they have been or what they have done. When you look to them, it's the eyes of Jesus that is going to deliver those people. Just keep going, Barry. You're in a good place. Hallelujah. Okay, Norm. Norm is going to share communion.
Two, one. Yeah. Hello. Passover is less than 2 weeks away. So not next Saturday, but the Saturday after. Please be here at 5:30, before 5:30. 5:15 is good to be here, because we need to be seated down ready to start exactly at 5:30. Otherwise, it'll be midnight and no dinner. So it's really, really important that you prepare yourself for this event. It's an appointment with God. And I just want to share something really powerful. The Passover is based on four cups. So we take communion, it's representing the four cups. And the four cups represent the four I wills of God. It's a covenant promise out of Exodus chapter 6. Now, the first cup is called the Kadesh. It's the cup of sanctification. Now, the big key to understanding your freedom, it's not about I'm being freed from this and that. It's actually about their destination. So when Moses went before Pharaoh, he didn't say, let my people go because what you're doing is wrong. It's slavery. They're getting beaten up. No. He said, no, they need to come and worship him at his mountain. It's the destination that's important, not where you're coming from. The first part of your path to freedom, sanctification, is I'm leaving Egypt to go somewhere. What's your purpose? If you don't know your purpose and your destiny, you will perish. Without a vision, my people perish. Why are we here? Where are we going to? What is the destination? What is your purpose? It is so important. So a human being cannot be someone else's slave because he's already committed to his purpose that God gave him when he created him. You cannot be a slave when you have a different purpose. The enemy has to let you go. Really, really simple. The beginning of all journeys is separation. You've got to leave somewhere to go somewhere else. Pharaoh will cry at you when you're going through this. Now, it is a bit of a warning. If you are serious about this Passover and walking free, you've got to remember Pharaoh's going to be yelling at you. He's going to be putting things in your way and saying no. He's going to come up with excuses why you can't do it. No, I'm going on a destiny and I'm going to fulfill my purpose, which is to worship him. So that's like what the first cup's about. So let's stand up and get into communion. Now, the important thing I'll teach about this Tuesday night is that the more you meditate on the broken body, on the bread and what it represents, the more you meditate on the blood of Jesus, what these four cups represent, the more your emotions will get involved in it. And the more of your being that is wrapped up in about what you're doing, the more you're going to see freedom. So when we're taking communion, it's like this, Lord, we come before your holiness right now. We come before your glory. And we are not satisfied with where we're at. We want to be in your glory. We want to touch your presence. We want to touch your heart. We thank you that Jesus, through his broken body, through his piercings and his stripes, he set us free from those things so that we could come in and worship you and be one with you. We believe that when we're taking this bread, we're touching the very presence of Jesus. We're touching his flesh. And we thank you, Lord, that his healing power is going to go into our bodies and it's going to make us free. That you're going to violently move by your Holy Spirit upon each and every person in this congregation, listening on YouTube, Facebook, and Zoom right now. That your Holy Presence, when we take this bread, is going to go into us and make us free in the name of Jesus. We're going to see the healing power. We're going to close our eyes and imagine your holy presence moving into our lungs, moving into our minds, into our nervous system. We see the hands of Jesus touching our flesh right now. We see the hands of Jesus going into us and making us whole. We thank you, Lord. We receive your power right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. We right now speak to our own Egypts, those things that have been making us slave drivers, those frustrations, those depression, those fears right now, everything that is saying, no, you're going to stay here. We speak to you in the blood of Jesus and we say, by the stripes of Jesus, we're healed. By his blood, you have, as Colossians chapter 3 says, you have, that the Father has stripped all legal authority and right over the devil right now and translated us into the kingdom of his son right now. We believe that no legal right does the enemy have over us any longer because of the blood. We thank you, Lord, that we are free people because of the blood. In the name of Jesus, I thank you, Lord, that the blood of Jesus is setting our marriages free. It's setting our children free. We thank you, Lord, we can see all of our family members coming out of prison right now to worship you. We thank you, Lord, that the blood of Jesus has set us free. It has redeemed us, it has delivered us, and is making us one with you right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. See you all at Passover. And if you can't attend, please log on to our website. You can still participate via Zoom and YouTube. It's really, really important.
Am I on? Right. Anyone got something, not a personal word of encouragement? We'll leave that till later on because Paul has got a message today. Anyone got a word during worship that just a vision just today, not on your way to work or last week? What the Lord is speaking to us right now. Amen. Anyone got a vision during worship? Just come quickly and share something here. Thanks. Use this mic.
When we first started to worship, I saw a staircase going to heaven, and I saw angels ascending and descending. And the ones that were ascending were taking sickness, and they were taking diseases, and they were taking just ugly things that I don't know what they were. And the ones that were coming down were carrying gifts, and they were just up and down, just this, it was just like an exchange between the sicknesses and the diseases and the gifts. And then after a while in worship, I saw another vision and I saw the river. I saw the river of God and it was just blue and it was shimmering and it was just wonderful. And I saw in this, at the start of it, it was a jungle setting and people were just running. They were running from the jungle and jumping into that river.
Wow.
And the river just kept going. It just kept going and it was going through nations. And I saw it going through China and I saw Chinese people jumping into the river. And I saw Indian people, I saw European people, and I just saw more and more and more and more people, and they were all running to the river. And when they jumped in the river, their skin began to glow, and I saw their eyes were like diamonds. And I just saw that they were filled with joy. It was like this joy that was just emanating from them. And that just the river was just, it was just billions and billions and billions of people, but it was the urgency, it was the running and jumping into the river that I really noticed.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. There is a river of God flowing out through me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Okay, Paul, come forward.
He's got one job to do. Really? Praise God. What a great day. What a great worship. What a great mess. Hi. Passover's coming. Praise God for Passover. Easter's coming. Praise God for everything that has for us. Before I start, I want you to know that you'll hear things. You'll hear a lot. I'm starting at Genesis and going through to Revelations. Don't expect to get it all at once. But the bit God speaks to you, take hold of. If you get a word, which you will, you will, you all will, there'll be something today for you. Grab hold of that something. Don't go searching for everyone else's something.
I don't know whether you've ever laid awake at night thinking about stuff and had stuff. I was asked to bring a word last week when we left. Ainsley asked me if I'd bring a word. And before I got out the door, I had a title. Tuesday night, I laid in bed until 3 o'clock in the morning with stuff going over my head. Wednesday night, I laid 3 o'clock in the morning, stuff going over my head. This morning, 2 o'clock in the morning, stuff going over my head. So I'm thinking this is probably important because it's kept me awake. So I'm going to keep you awake. And you. Just because I can't see you all, no sleeping, no going to the toilet, hang on to it. God's plan, the mercy seat. That's the word for today. In Exodus 25:17, we see God telling Moses, "You shall make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2 cubits," he gives him the measurements, exact measurements. He's telling Moses, "You shall make a mercy seat of pure gold. This many cubits, that many cubits, you'll do this, we'll have that, we'll have the other thing." And he tells him about the ark, about making the ark. It's a box. And verse 21 says, "And you shall put the mercy seat on the top of the ark." So he's given him the measurements for the Ark of the Covenant, what we know of, which was a box and overlaid with gold. Then on top of that, separate to that, is the mercy seat where the cherubim are over like that. So when we see pictures of the Ark of the Covenant, we just see this box with this. And we sort of imagine, I sort of imagine, one thing. It's not. It's two things. One is a box that contains stuff. The other is the mercy seat. "You shall put the mercy seat on the top of the ark, and in the ark you shall put the testimony that I shall give you." In the ark is God's testimony, not man's testimony. It's God's testimony. It's God's testimony. "And in the ark you shall put the testimony, and there I will meet you from above the mercy seat." That's God's chosen meeting place for his people as Moses took them out and led them out. And we see that God gave some specific, it was a God's design, God's pattern, God's plan for his people, and it was God's plan to actually make the ark and the mercy seat exact specifications given. He had to give that to somebody he could trust to do it exactly as he needed it done. He trusted Moses. In Hebrews 9:4, it tells us what was in the Ark of the Covenant, and in which the golden urn holding manna. So there was a golden urn holding some of the manna that they had as they went through the 40 years. It didn't go off, yet every day it said if you didn't eat it in the day, go rotten. This didn't, because it was part of God's testimony for the future. In it was Aaron's staff that budded. I'm not going to read those stories. I'd be here till whenever tonight. And in it were the tablets of the covenant. Now, we know that's, of course, the photocopy because the original got smashed up, went through the shredder, and Moses had to go and get a second copy. But that's what was in the box, God's testimony. Then on the box is the mercy seat. In Exodus 26, "And you shall bring the veil..." It's talking about the tabernacle now and the layout of the tabernacle. He told Moses exactly how the tabernacle was to be built, laid out, what was to go where, exactly the sizes of it, who was to go where, who could do what. What could do what? Only certain people are allowed to do certain things, and if anyone else did certain things, not a good thing. A very bad thing. Bring the Ark of the Testimony in there within the veil, and the veil shall separate you, the holy place, from the most holy place. And you shall put the mercy seat on the Ark of the Testimony in the most holy place. So we've got the Ark with the Testimony and the mercy seat in the most holy place, where the high priest, we know, would go once a year, sprinkle the sacrifice, and he was the only one that could go in there. So God had very specific pattern and plan for the Ark and the mercy seat and the whole tabernacle. What's that? Is that me? Is that all right? No, somebody didn't like the word. Devil, out. Tough. You lose. Look, you lose, devil. However, I'll just say this. God had a pattern and a plan. God's got a pattern and a plan for us specifically. Each one of you had your own pattern, the thing that he can trust you with as he trusted Moses. However, you see, a pattern is only a pattern until it's put in the hands of a craftsman or an artisan. You can go to a shop and buy a pattern for a dress, a suit, or whatever. You can leave it at your home forever. It's a pattern. That's all it is. You can ask Steve Garain, a builder. He's got blueprints. It's a pattern of a house, a building, extensions. While it's on the paper, it's only a pattern. Not until it's put in the hand of an artisan, the specifications exactly, not until it's put in the hand of somebody you can trust, does it ever come to fruition. Yeah. It's still only a pattern. The pattern can sit in your drawer forever and be useless. God's given you stuff to do. God's got a pattern for you. If you don't take it up, if you don't put your hand to it, if you don't do the action, it's still only going to be a pattern. You'll die with it. Amen. Yes. He doesn't want to see the pattern. He's given you the pattern. God's pattern is perfect every time. Not maybe, it's perfect. He knows the outcome. When he wrote the pattern, he knew what he wanted to see at the end. He didn't want to see a pattern. He doesn't want to see you going, oh, God's given me a vision. 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 And what are you doing with that vision? Oh, I'm praying about it. Put your hands to it. He wants you to do something with it, not just talk about your vision. He wants you to put action to his vision, to his pattern for your life. We keep hearing, where the pattern's right, the glory will fall. Amen. The pattern was right when he wrote it. Yes. But he's looking for the people he trusts with the pattern to bring it to pass. Yes. Is that us? Is that what he wants us to do? You better see what he wants us to do. Have I ever preached like this? Don't be stupid. It's the pattern. That's God's idea. But I'll tell you what, he has something very special. I just spat and there's no one in the front row to... Eli, come here and let me spit on you. What a waste of a good spit that was. So you get the message. The pattern's only a pattern. It'll stay in the packet until you put some work to it. So when God tells you, as he told Jeremiah, I know the plans I have for you, they are plans for good. That's his pattern for you. When you get the prophet prophesying over you, that's a pattern for you. Take hold of that. Pray over that. Take your hand to it. Put your hand to the plow and don't look back. Get to work. You see, you can actually believe God when he gives you a word. You can believe God when he gives you something to do. You can believe God when he tells you. And that girl there, I've been waiting to see you for 2-3 weeks. What's her name? Esther. God bless you, Esther. 3 weeks ago, I think it was, I had a word for you. You went to the kids' church. No, you're too old for that. No, you're not. You're probably going to be a teacher. I want to tell you, it's like you come in this place in worship, in time. You look around, you see these people, and to you, it's like you're standing out in the middle of this street and they're all getting soaked with the rain of the glory. And you're standing there saying, I wish I could get some of that. But you're not feeling it. But you get your umbrella. ready, because you're going to be in the middle of a storm, because God's got his hand on you. And don't you think for one minute, because all these people are feeling it and you're not, that you don't have it. You have it. God's got his hand on you. And I didn't want to say that to your mum for her to tell you. I want you to hear it, because God's got his hand on you. And don't you worry about what everyone else thinks or says about you or what you've got to do. God's got a plan for you. In Leviticus 16:1-3 says, tell Aaron your brother not to come at any time into the holy place inside the veil. This is part of that pattern for the mercy seat. Even Moses wasn't allowed to go in there. It was only Aaron. Moses. You think Moses would be allowed to go there any time because he saw God face to face? No. Moses wasn't even allowed to go in there. Only Aaron, because God appointed Aaron. Moses had to tell Aaron exactly. Don't shortcut. Moses had to tell Aaron exactly what God had him to do. He says, tell him not to come at any time when he just feels like coming to see me. Don't tell him not to come inside the veil before the mercy seat, which is on the ark, lest he die. You make the mistake, do it in your own way, you can die physically, spiritually, mentally. You know something? You grab hold of what God and listen to what he's got for you. In Samuel 6:3-7, this is when the ark is being brought into David and everybody's so excited they've got the ark back and they're bringing it to Jerusalem, to the holy city. They are so excited. This is great. It's on a cart and they're bringing it in. Uzzah and Ahio, it sounds like a U.S. state, doesn't it? Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, were driving the new cart with the ark of God, and Ahio went before the ark. And David and, grab hold of this, David and all the house of Israel were celebrating before God with songs and lyres and harps and tambourines and castanets and cymbals. They were having a hallelujah time. They were glorifying God. They were singing and dancing, praising God. Hallelujah. Bringing the ark into Jerusalem. They were doing all the right things, praising God to the max, kicking their heels up, singing hallelujah, raising hallelujah. And the ark tipped, and Uzzah stuck out his hand to stop the ark from falling off. What a great man of God. He didn't want the ark to spill out everywhere and the mercy seat to fall on the ground. So he did the right thing. I'll stop it. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God struck him dead. In the middle of a praise and worship session like we've never had in our life. You think just because you're praising and worshiping, you can't kindle God's anger? Just because you're singing and dancing and praising God, you think God's not really seeing what's going on? I feel sorry for Uzzah. He was trying to do the right thing. And David didn't like it either. You see, even during praise and worship, a man puts his hand out and touches the thing he's not allowed to touch, and he dies. Where's God's grace and mercy in that? Really? Is that fair, God? Well, it's not up to me to judge that. It happened. And it says God's anger was kindled. Oh. What do we know, really? I better move on. We're here forever. So danger looms even when there's praise and worship going on. Make sure your heart is right towards God. Make sure you are right where he wants. The ark by itself, remember, only was a container of stuff. It's that mercy seat that's the deadly thing. the mercy seat. David cried out and he yelled. Now, I want you to imagine something. Come for this little walk. I'm going to read probably a lot of this so I don't forget it. Imagine the meeting of Almighty God and the trio. God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Discussing mankind. God's up there, he says, I have a dream. I have a dream, guys. Where all mankind, all people of every tribe and every nation can come directly to our mercy seat without fear of death. I've got a dream. And Jesus goes, what? And the Spirit goes, oh, cool. God the Father says, remember Uzzah? Oh, yeah, remember that. And God says, the pattern is simple. But it's not easy. The pattern is simple. Guys, but it's not easy. The fulfillment of this plan requires someone who is 100% without sin to take this pattern to the end. And son, that someone is you. You'll be called and known throughout ages as Yeshua, Jesus, forever. Jesus said, well, I can do that. No problem. We will need to forecast the whole thing. So we'll use prophets throughout the years to forewarn people, to let people know how this is going to take place so that when it takes place, they'll know. So it won't just be bing, we didn't know that was going to happen. So we're going to actually get prophets throughout the years and it'll be put into place. There'll be words spoken. There'll be things written. People will know. The story will go before so that when it happens, they won't be surprised. They'll go, oh, that's what that was about. And they'll know that it was always my plan for their salvation. My Spirit, you'll go first and you'll plant a seed in someone very special who I'll select for you to plant a seed in. It's got to be in the line of David. So I'll find the person, the right person, and I'll anoint them and then you'll be born as a human. And when you're born and you grow up, son, like a human being, you'll grow in wisdom and stature, in favour with us and with all men. Read about it in Luke 2:52. I'm not making this stuff up. This is just my way of telling you what the Bible says, all right? Jesus, you will need to get a band of brothers together, a group, get some guys together, get some, you know, mentor them, disciples, people you can teach because you're only going to be there for a period of time, but this has got to go on after you're gone. So I want you to train some people up, people you can trust to give the vision to, people you really trust that will carry this out for you, for us. You'll even perform miraculous signs and wonders in front of people. You'll even change water to wine. Man, what a party trick. You can do that. The blind will see. The deaf will hear. Sickness and disease will just fall off people. Amen. Lepers will be healed, cured, 100%. They'll be totally healed at your word, Jesus. Son, demons are going to flee when you speak to them. They're going to rush out. You're going to know the demons are down there and they're going to run when they see you. They're going to be afraid of you without you even speaking and they're going to run. People are going to be set free from the bondage they've been in all their life. Dead men are even going to be raised by you. Can you feel this? Can you be, are you here? All of these things are going to be, they're going to be part of the testimony that's going to go on. The testimony of how good we are. Our purpose for man forever, eternally. You are being sent that man can be free. These testimonies are going to be recorded into history, written. They're going to be carried on in millennia, remembered, taught, taught in schools, taught in church. There's going to be people talking about you and what you've done. And they're going to come to you, to us, through you, what you've done. Your disciples are going to learn. And when your job there is finished, it's going to send the Spirit down, but that's another plan. I'll talk to you later about that one. But Jesus, and Jesus is going, that sounds like fun. I can do that. No problems. Let's do this. Yeah, well, before you leave to come back here, you have to do something that even you're going to struggle with. See, you and I are going to have some really close conversations. We're going to have a real heart-to-heart on this. You actually need, you know, we put the Passover, remember that with Moses, we did that, right? You have to become the final Passover lamb. It's your blood that's going to set man free. When the time is right, you'll have a final Passover meal with those guys you've been discipling, the team you've got, your disciples. You're going to have a meal with them. And at that time, you're going to institute something brand new. You're going to show them something that they can do to remember you and what you've done. They're going to call it the communion table. You're going to take the matzah and show them exactly why we instituted that back there and what it's done for them here. And when you take that bread out and you tell them, this is my body, they're not going to quite understand it just yet until you go down and sort it out later. Then you're going to take that one cup, the one nobody's ever been able to take before, and you're going to show them that this is your blood poured out for all mankind. Then they'll start to get a little bit of understanding. But they are going to remember that night. They're going to remember the night, the Passover meal they had with you. And it's going to go into eternity. Because on that night, it's going to be not just a party time. Jesus goes, this is sounding simple. I don't see the big deal. No big deal. Yeah, but see, one of your disciples, the ones you've trained up, is actually going to turn on you on this very night. He's going to leave early. He's going to hand you over to religious zealots and the political people because he's not going to agree with everything you've been teaching him. He's going to think there's another way, a better way, that you're not the one you said you were. Your heart is going to become so extensively heavy, you're going to feel that we need to have a real close chat. Come to a garden that I give to you and we'll talk it through. But I want you to know I have complete faith in you because I know you will do what needs to be done for this plan to be fulfilled 100% as I plan and need it to be for the people's sake into eternity. Over the next 3 days, you're going to suffer like no man has ever suffered before, ever. You're going to be brought before the religious people, the priests, the high priests. You're going to be judged by the Roman guards, the emperors. Say nothing. You'll be stripped naked. You'll be whipped. You'll be beaten beyond recognition. You're going to have a huge crown of thorns pulled down on top of your head so that the blood vessels just burst. And the blood's going to be running down your face. You're not going to be recognizable. Your eyes are going to feel like they're popping out of your head. You're going to be spat upon, cursed, mocked. The physical cross is going to be dropped on your shoulders. You've already been whipped to shreds. The raw skin, the blood, the meat's going to be hanging off. They're going to drop this cross on your shoulder and make you drag it up the streets until you can't carry it anymore. Jesus is going, when you reach the assigned place called Golgotha, outside the town, they're going to strip you again and nail you to the cross that you've been carrying. Your arms will be stretched so hard, they're going to feel like they're going to pop out of the sockets. And they're going to nail your arms to the cross beams. They're going to cross your feet. And they're going to whack nails straight into it. To the point where you're not going to be able to stand. You're not going to be able to breathe. Every breath you take is going to be a struggle. They're going to pierce your side with a spear. And blood and water will pour out. That blood and water is the beginning, as was the blood from your head and the whipping. That's the beginning of man's turnaround. Jesus goes, look, let me just think about this for a minute, huh? After some hours of this torture, you will feel and experience the total weight of the sin of the world on you. Past, present, and future. The weight of that sin will make you feel as though even I have forsaken you. Jesus goes, can we vote on who does what? I mean, really? What you do have to know is that we will be with you through the whole ordeal. We will never leave you nor forsake you, even though you may feel at that time as though we're not there. Then, during the thick darkness that's been over this whole area, as soon as you speak your last few words, drop your eyes, take your last breath, kapow! The earth is going to shake. The veil in the temple will be torn, top to bottom. The priests and the Roman guards, they're going to be really shaking in their boots. They're going to be running for the hills. They're not going to know what's going on. They're going to know that they've witnessed something they've never seen before and will never see again. Out of this world. Jesus goes, kapow? Kapow! That's not all. Not quite. The graves are going to open. Some who have gone to sleep earlier are going to get up out of their graves. They're going to go into town, make themselves known to their family and friends. They're going to go, what? Don't ask me. The door was open, so out I went. No idea what's going on. Read Matthew 27:45-55 to see that I'm not making that up. And Jesus says, so then I come back here. Well, no, not quite yet. First, you go down to Hades. Of course I do, he says. Go to hell. Yeah, great idea. Kill me, thrash me, break me, smash me, hang me on a cross and send me to hell. Thank you, Dad. I love you too. Really? Surely there's got to be another way. No. You go down to hell. You go down to Hades. And you minister to those who have been down there. And you take the keys to sin, hell, and death. And you just take them back. Amen. And you don't even say, thank you, devil. He doesn't deserve thanks, anything. Just take him back and you stare him down. He will know he's looking at Almighty God and he's got nowhere to go. You take those, you minister those people down there and you open up the door and they will be set free. Then you come back to earth for a little while. Show yourself to your disciples. Show them that what you told them is true, that you had to die, that this had to happen for them and for future generations, for the past, for Uzzah. I really pray that Uzzah got free out of that. I don't think that was fair at all. You'll be there until the morning of the third day. Then on the third day, people are going to come and the tomb's going to be have the stone roll back and you're not even going to be there. And you wouldn't have even left a tip for the cleaner. You're gone. But you need to show them what has gone on. Then after a time when you've seen your disciples, you'll be raised bodily before their very eyes, in their sight, so you can take your rightful place right here beside me until it's time for you to go back to rule and reign for 1,000 years. But that's another plan. We'll talk to you later about that. Jesus goes, So what's just happened? Seriously? Son, you've just become final and eternal sacrificial lamb. Your blood at this point is being poured out once and for all the sacrifice, Hebrews 10:10. And because of what you've agreed and chosen to do of your free will, they can have their sins totally forgiven. They can receive you as their Lord and Savior and forever have us living within them so their lives can be led and guided by the plan that we have for them. I will put my law on their hearts and write them on their minds. I will remember their sins no more because of what you've done. Their lawless deeds will be finished because of what you did. Hebrews 10:16-17. With the veil being torn and the Holy of Holies totally open, the mercy seat becomes a place where man can come directly without having to have the high priest come, because there is no sacrifice good enough for them. You've done it. You've basically become their permanent high priest forever. They can come boldly and directly with the confidence drawing near to the throne of grace that they may ever receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of trouble. Hebrews 4:15-16. Jesus says, so, all right, then let's say I agree to do this. What does he do? It seems like the Spirit's got getting off pretty light with all this. And Father said, don't think that, because when you come back here, he's got to go down there And you've got to live with these people, inside these people, listening to their griping, their backsliding, their bitching, their moaning, their whinging, their complaining, their re-sinning. You think you're going to have it tough? You wait. His is yet to come. I reckon you're not getting off lightly, but... What do you think? Will you do it? Oh, let me pray about this. All right. I'll do it. I knew I could count on you, son. And so will everyone else that ever was, ever is, and ever will be. They'll be counting on you. They need to accept you as their Lord and Savior, but they've got the testimony. They've got the ark full of the testimony of what you've just done for them, what we put in place for them, and that mercy seat on top of the ark that's been washed by the blood of the Lamb once and for all. I knew I could count on you, son. So we know by the word of God that Jesus absolutely accepted the challenge. And I reckon the ark is full of testimonies. The old ones, the manna, the buddy, wherever the ark is, you know. But we've got this ark in here. We've got the testimony of what God has done for each and every one of us. The testimony, your testimony, is not your testimony. It's a testimony of what God has done in you. See, it's a testimony of what He's done, not what you've done, not how well you prayed and look what God did for me. No, that's not the testimony. Look, you come to me because I pray really well because look at the magic stuff that happens when I pray. No. Be careful, loser. Rising and weeping and praising God. Don't touch that one. Be careful. Even during praising and leaping and doing all the right things, pow, God's anger was aroused. You need to be careful. Hebrews 4. Hang on, I've got something highlighted. Jesus became our high priest. He's given us access to the mercy seat, washed in His precious blood by God's grace. Hebrews 4, 14 to 16. Seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who can't sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, worse than we were, and yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Hebrews 10, 19 to 23. Therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which He consecrated for us through the veil, that is His flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near with true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for He who promised is faithful. Now, I want you all to leave here today. I want you guys up in that place, Zoom land, whatever other land is out there, all you guys, know that God's hand and love is upon you. Know that He's got your very own plan, but you've got to put your hand to the plan, otherwise it's going to sit in the packet, sit in the drawer, and you'll never get to wear that cardigan. Do people still wear cardigans? That's right. The mercy seat is where you actually admit your sin. Be careful. If you don't have to admit sin, you don't need mercy. The only people that need mercy, and not you'll never find anyone in the scripture, Jesus, Son of God, have grace on me. They never cried out for grace, ever. Have grace on me, Lord. None of them. The blind man. Lord, give me grace. Okay. No, every single one of them, have mercy on me, Lord. And he said, your sins are forgiven. Then the others said, how can you forgive sins? Well, do you reckon it's easier for me to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? Do that anyway. What do you reckon now? We need to come to the mercy seat knowing that we've got the sin that we cannot pay for. He paid the price for a sin he never committed. We need to go before the judge. Yes, I am deserving of punishment for my sin. Lord, I come before you and ask that you would pardon me, give me mercy. Done. Next. Done. That quick. Because Jesus did it for you. But don't dare come saying, I'm washed by the blood. I've got nothing to be. I don't need the mercy because I've got grace. Okay. Try it. Let me know how it works out for you. And never doubt when God gives you a word or something to do, never doubt for a minute that he's not going to empower you and give you the strength to carry out the thing he's said he wants you to do. It's your choice whether you do it or not. But know this, if he said it, trust him, he's going to do it through you if you want. And know that he loves you. Look what Jesus has done. And we look forward to the next part when he returns to take his place, ruling and reigning for 1,000 years, as Revelations 20, 4-6 tells us. Father, I thank you. I thank you for your word. I thank you that there's so much in this. Some people just don't think that they are strong enough, or they've got it in their heart to carry out the words that you've spoken. Lord, they should know the plans you have for them are plans for good, not to harm them. But Lord, that you will help them and you'll carry them through. And I just thank you as they come before that mercy seat, they know that the veil was rent through what Jesus did. He took all that on himself so that we wouldn't have to go to a priest or anybody else to get us a blessing. We can go straight to the mercy seat and receive direct from you. And I thank you for it and pray blessing on every need. And there's needs in this place. There's needs out there, Lord. I pray your blessing that you would touch each and every one in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. What an awesome message. Thank you, Lord. Mercy rewrote my life. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. So much true, isn't it? You can't cry out for grace. You cry out for mercy. But why do you cry out for mercy? You explained it really well today. Amen. Because we're all sinners saved by grace. Amen. We're all sinners saved by grace. Anyone out there, anyone on Zoom, on YouTube, Father, right now, Lord God, anyone, Lord, who do not know you today, Father God. Lord, you reveal yourself by this message today, Father, that you are full of love and mercy, Lord. You without sin, Father. There was no sin in you, Lord. You took all our sins. That we realize, Lord, that we were sinners saved by grace, Lord. Today we come boldly to you, Lord, and we ask you, Lord, we declare, just repeat after me, church, because there could be people listening to us outside. I do not know who you are, your condition in God, or where you are in God. You can know the whole Bible backwards. You can know it. This is not Bible bashing, but this is asking Jesus to come and be your personal Savior. It's up to you, church. You got to make that decision. But all we can do is to lead you with this whole message of what God's plan for you, because he's got a plan and a purpose, not only for you, for your entire household and family. I alone, the Bible says, I alone know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. It's not coming from the Lord. not to harm you, but to give you a future and a hope. But you got to make that decision that you are a sinner and you need God's grace. You got to cry out for mercy from the depths of your heart. Because we all have sinned. We are born with sin, born with corruption, born with sin. It's tattooed in us. But guess what, church? As you make this commitment and say, God, yes, I'm a sinner. I need your mercy today. God will come and His blood is so powerful, greater than your mommy's or daddy's blood. This blood is going to come from the Father God right through you and wash your sins away and make you whiter than snow. But you've got to declare that you're a sinner and you need God and you need grace. This is not going to church and sign a book and being a member of some denomination or some book or our church or any other church in the world. This got something to do with you. Personally, I'm speaking to you right now. It's got to do with you and God. Nothing to do with me or anybody else. Just say, Lord Jesus, I open up my heart. I know I have sinned, Lord. But today, Lord, I got your message, Lord, that it's your blood that washes my sin away. I cry out for mercy. You know, Lord, everything that's going on in my life, in my family, in my loved ones. You know my grief. You know my pain. You know my weakness. I ask you right now, Lord, to come into my life. Be the Lord of my life. I decree and declare that you died for my sins and you rose again. In Jesus' name, come right into my heart, Lord. Lock the door and throw the keys away. I welcome you, Jesus. Wash my past and my sins away and make me complete and whole. I receive everything that you have purchased for me on Calvary. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Lord, that I decree and declare that you will be Lord of every area of my life. In Jesus' name. Give the Lord a clap, church. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord. If you meant it with your heart, church, and you said it for the first time, just get onto our webpage or come and see one of us, the leaders in the church, and they will give you some literature. They will give you something or pray for you and lead you into that place. And your life will never be the same as you acknowledge that you are a sinner and you need his mercy and grace. He's just handed over to you. And you don't have to go tomorrow and then and tell him anything because he don't have a bad memory. He just washed it away. Amen. That's how good it is. That's how quick it is. Amen. All right. Don't forget the prayer meetings every day on Zoom. Well, we might be getting into the church Sunday night as well. So, but at the moment, we'll be on Zoom till all this thing is happening in Brisbane too. One of the hospitals have been shut down, locked down, closed up. But Jesus is going to move in there. Amen. He's going to take this coronavirus right out of our land. We got to believe, church. The prayer meetings and six hours on Saturday from 6 to 12 every Saturday. Try and get on. Church, awesome things are happening. I've been sharing a few things. Try and make it tonight because I got something really powerful to share. We'll be on Zoom tonight. And also the men's meeting is on Tuesday. Torah teaching, so try and get in here as well. Anything else I missed out on? Janet, you got something? The Passover money. He's talking about the Passover. Jesus is the Passover. Amen. So anyone who have booked in for the Passover, because I think we are full up, just give Jan $10 plus. And don't forget to fill the tithes and offerings. Sorry, we can't take it around. You got to come in here and give it, put it in here, fill this box right up. I will definitely get a bigger box next time. And thanks all those who have been helping us and walking with us through this difficult time, through and supporting us, because most of you have been putting your tithes and offerings in the on the internet, through the church, through the web, website. The bank account numbers are there. So give abundantly to the Lord Church because we want to take this to the nations. Isn't that thing that Norm has put together recently? Did all of you watch that? You know what God is doing in this church? It's just outstanding. You know, that we're taking it around the world. There are people on Zoom there from Fiji and wherever else around the world. And you know what I mean? People are coming in from all over the world, church. From Melbourne, Sydney, our friends, Kathy, and many, many people are coming in and joining us for the meeting. Just in our morning prayer meetings, if you count everyone that's watching, we got about 40 to 50 people in the morning prayer meetings daily. Isn't that awesome, church? Give the Lord a clap. This is, God is breaking through things in our lives, church. Signs, wonders, miracles, compassions, love, you know, of God that people have never experienced. I'm talking about Christians. God is bringing them so closer to God, and you will see the change in their lives. I ministered to somebody yesterday, this week. Continue to pray for Rochelle and her family. You know, she had a really encounter while I was praying for her and her sister just before she passed away. On the phone, God just touched Rochelle's life. She's a different woman, church. God even prepared her. Wow. Because her loving sister that she prayed so long and tried to minister to her, God just did something in Rochelle's life, and she'll never be the same again, you know. She experienced the glory of God coming into that room. She couldn't even walk, church. And people around there didn't know what was happening to her, but God was with her. Amen. Hallelujah. The world is going to know what Jesus can do. Just continue to pray for Rochelle and our whole family as well. And also for Dindi, church, if you can lift him up in prayer. We need to see that that cancer totally leaving his body. Amen? That doesn't belong because Paul's message, what an excellent message. Jesus suffered. He went through such marred beyond recognition. He took all cancer, all diseases, 2000. That's why we pray very aggressively because it doesn't belong to Dindi's body or any of you watching me today at the sound of my voice. That sickness, that disease, that negative report does not belong to your body. And what God is doing daily, if you come in there, you can see what's happening. There is unbelievable transformation. These are Christians, born again, spirit-filled. They know all about God, but God is taking them from one level of glory to another. But you've got to be open and teachable to what God is doing in this church. All right. Bless you all. Love you all. Thanks for coming. Have a fantastic day and see you tonight. Don't forget to put your tithes and offerings in there. Yeah, we'll be right. So easy.
तुम जा प्रे करेगा मतलब बोले सब तू कर दे जा कर दे ओ आगे जा 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 बोले कर ले Thank you.